afternoon. I am, I cannot tell you how happy I am to be here. And a little emotional, actually, because to be back on campus, so right off the bat, not even a sentence in, to be back on campus at a place that so nurtured and launched me and made me believe that really almost anything was possible, and to have the vantage point now to look back knowing that and very aware of how blessed and privileged my life is, and largely because of my experience at what was then Weber State College. It was that long ago. And so being back on campus is emotional. It's also tremendous to see so many longtime friends who have taken the time to show up here, which means so much to me, both part of the Weber State family and personal friends. And then also to be here as the inaugural speaker for the Jane and Tammy Marquardt Peace and Possibility series. I am a lawyer because of Jane Marquardt. So you can either credit or blame her, depending on your perspective. Jane really has been one of the most important mentors in my life. And not only is a very, very dear and close friend, but really is an individual who made me believe at a time when I wasn't sure that I could do something as daunting at the time as go to law school, who pretty much set me down and said, "What are you talking about? Absolutely, you can and should go to law school. And so it's your fault, Jane." And it's important, I think, also to be aware of the moment in which we're having this conversation, where peace seems fragile and possibility seems unlikely, and to have this conversation in the political climate that we're currently in. And I think that's also essentially ups the responsibility to really have an honest conversation about what are we called to do in this moment. The favorite opening, my favorite Martin Luther King quote opens with this sentence: "Power without love is reckless and abusive." And we are witnessing the truth of that statement now. Power without love is reckless and abusive. We are seeing this in action, but the central question is, how do we respond? What are we called to do in a moment where we believe that power is being exercised in a way that is abusive and not caring and elevating the values that are most important to us? Inclusion, equality, justice, celebration of difference, really the sense of our democracy. Prior to November, I had this view that our democracy was an evolving democracy. I now feel that it is much more of an imperiled and fragile democracy. So what does that mean for us as citizens in a democracy, all sitting here with relative privilege? Now, we all come to this space differently. Some of us have race privilege, some of us has geographic privilege, some of us have education privilege. But it is clear that almost everyone in this room has a greater degree of privilege than those most targeted for harm by this administration. So what do we do? What do we do in this moment where it doesn't feel like we have much power to change the course of events? In moments like this, I think it's enormously important to put where we are now in some context. And while we haven't maybe faced quite the level of existential threat that I feel like we're facing now, we have had moments like this before. In the days after the election, I saw a video by Sherrilyn Ifill, who is the executive director of the NAACP Legal Defense Fund. And quite powerfully, she recorded this video just a couple of days before her cousin Gwen Ifill died of cancer. And what she said to her members and the supporters of the NAACP LDF was, "Folks, I understand you're nervous and concerned and maybe fearful, but we've seen things like this before. In the 1950s, by the dozens, black men were being lynched in the South. and we could not find a member of Congress to carry legislation to ban lynching. And the president said if such legislation were introduced, he would not sign it. Jim Crow was rife throughout the South. Brown versus Board of Education was being fiercely resisted. An entire swath of our population felt like they had a target on their back. Fast forward. In the 1980s, we were hit as an LGBT community with the HIV/AIDS crisis. And the government at the time, Ronald Reagan, president, mocked the idea that the government should even care that tens of thousands of gay men were dying. So what did we do? Out of nothing, we built an infrastructure to care for the men and later women who were dying, to provide support, and to force the government to care and get involved and devote resources. Even more recent history, in the lifetime of everyone in this room, in 2008, two things happened in California within 6 months of each other that represented the zenith of my career and the nadir of my career as a lawyer. The first was winning marriage in the state of California. NCLR was lead counsel on the case that won marriage before the California Supreme Court. And I remember as I stood on the steps on this beautiful May spring day in 2008, and this picture got captured from a friend, which I love because I'm thrusting the decision over my head, and I'm not thinking, oh wow, this is great, we just won marriage. That's not the thought I had. The thought that I had was, this means that some gay kid in Brewton, Alabama is gonna feel better about his future. I knew that winning marriage would make a difference in the lives across the board, in every facet of the lives of LGBTQ people in this country. And then 6 months later, Prop 8 passed and eliminated the right to marry for same-sex couples. Worst night of my career. And then, 7 years later, we win marriage nationwide at the U.S. Supreme Court, again in a case the NCLR was involved in. 7 years. I mean, that is like a nanosecond in civil rights time. And how did we win marriage in 2015? Well, part of it was, of course, winning marriage in Utah, winning at the 10th Circuit, and one of our clients is here, it's so good to see you, babe. Winning, you know, building blocks, building the scaffolding to eventually have a national win. But I also believe we won marriage nationwide in 2015 because Prop 8 passed in 2008. And it shocked our community and allies out of the complacency that something like that would never happen in a place like California. So it is these moments where the unexpected happens and unmoors us and destabilizes our sense of what's possible and what might happen and what our expectations are. Those are the moments where we actually show up and do some of our very best work. So what we're called to do is to show up. No bystanding. No sitting on the sidelines. I mean, I, like many of my friends, and I was just talking to a close friend just before this started, I'm on a very strict news diet because I used to be a news junkie. NPR was always on in the car. It was always on at home. I was listening, you know, I was reading the New York Times, reading the Washington Post. Well, I will just say, I've completely restricted it, and it's been replaced by essentially hip hop and pop music, which is all I listen to now. And so, and actually it's a great swap. I would recommend it. So I feel like I stay informed just enough to know what's going on, because I do feel like I need to know what is going on. And part of it is a coping mechanism, so I understand. We all need to cope in whatever way we can, but there is no checking out. There is no bystanding. To bystand, to check out, is to be complicit in the harm that will be done. Our kids, when they were in middle school, Our son is now 20 and a sophomore at University of Maryland, and our daughter is a freshman in high school. But when they were in middle school, they had this curriculum that was, don't be a bystander. And, you know, it was, of course, very age appropriate for, you know, 10, 11, 12-year-olds. It was, you know, a kid falls down the stairs, you know, you stop and you help them up. A kid gets pushed into a locker, you intervene and say, hey, wait a minute, that's not okay, and you ask if they're okay. Anything that you see that you don't pass it by. And bystander theory is really interesting because the way bystander theory operates, and this has been tested multiple times, is that if you as an individual see a person in trouble, you are very likely to step up and say, like, you know, somebody looks like they, even if they're lost, they need directions, somebody actually is in a car accident or something, you as one person, nobody else around, you will intervene and help them. Demonstrated over and over again. But if there's a group that witnesses the action or the activity or the insult or the harm, no one responds. Because there is a sense that you're immediately, well, it must not be as bad as I think it is. Well, if no one else is getting involved, why should I get involved? I don't want to risk it. What would people think if I get involved? So you're much better off if something bad happens to you if only one person sees it. But this, we are now in the midst of a national insult that requires all of us to respond and not believe that somebody sitting next to us or on the next block or in the next town is going to respond. No being a bystander. And what does it mean, and who are we actually protecting? When we think about our work at the National Center for Lesbian Rights, in every bucket of work where people are being harmed, it touches our work. The Muslim ban. Well, guess what? There are LGBTQ Muslims. The immigration, the negative actions on immigration, and the over-enforcement around ICE activities. Guess what? LGBTQ people are immigrants. Of course, the withdrawal of the guidance that protected transgender youth in schools and reinforced that Title IX allows students to be able to use facilities consistent with their gender identity. Obviously, that's totally right in our wheelhouse. So in everything that this administration has already done to make people feel terrorized and threatened, there is a component, significant component, of the LGBTQ community. So we are right on the front lines of doing a lot of that work and pushing back and resisting and thinking about creative lawsuits and ways that we can respond. But beyond seeing that your own community is affected, there really has to be this animating question that we all ask ourselves. What kind of country do you want to live in? And I think that we actually really do. Forget partisan politics. We do want to live in a country where people can live with security and safety and dignity, and the government operates with integrity and support and fidelity and a thirst for justice and fair play. That's how a democracy thrives, is when citizens understand that even across difference, it matters, and our fight is the fight of anyone else who is targeted and dehumanized by policies that undermine their sense of themselves as a part of our human family. Movements are born from moments like this. Toni Morrison wrote recently in the wake of the election, "There is no time for despair, no place for self-pity, no need for silence, and no room for fear." Now, that is not to say that there won't be moments where you despair, moments where you feel fear. We all feel a little bit sorry for ourselves, that we wanted to have things maybe be a little bit differently, some of us. But we can't live there. We have to live in a place of boldness and audacity and courage, because that is how you repel a tyrant. And also, we have to do something that is the most challenging for me, and that is reaching across difference. Having conversations with people who do have a different political perspective, who do have a different worldview, who do have different notions of what makes a democracy strong and being willing to have those conversations. And I will say, I want to just admit straight up, this is a challenge for me. As even as a girl who grew up Mormon and who had a very loving Mormon mom and who has a very loving Mormon sister, I still am pretty judgy around religion and religious discrimination because, of course, I've seen religion used as a weapon to attack LGBT people. And so I struggle with meeting people where they are and being willing to have an open heart and an open mind. But I feel like more than ever, the other thing we're tested right now, be more courageous than we feel like we might want to be or could be or can be. We also have to do things differently than we've ever done. We can't stay in a bubble. We can't surround ourselves with only people who think the same way we do. We have to be willing to risk difficult conversations to come to some sense of common ground and shared vision. And my mother was a perfect example of how to do this. My mother was a devout Mormon her entire life. Went to church every Sunday. She was a true believer. And yet she was also completely supportive of me. When I came out to her, when I was 21, as we were driving to see my grandparents in Oregon, her parents, I don't know, it seemed like a good idea that I was going to tell her while we were in a moving vehicle. And I remember my partner at the time and I had rehearsed what we thought her reaction might be to me coming out. My mother would not be the type of person who would be like, that's it, you're dead to me, pull over, you're, get out of the car. She would never do that. I wasn't concerned about that. But the best reaction I thought I was going to get was, well, honey, I love you, of course, but I'm disappointed. And so I had to really kind of prepare myself that I think that's probably what's going to happen. So we're in the car, and my plan was to not tell her until we were maybe an hour from my grandparents. Then if it went badly, you know, it would be a short period of time, and then we'd be at my grandparents and couldn't talk about it anymore. But I swear, we hadn't even hit the Idaho border. And I'm like, Mom, I have something I have to tell you. And I started to get emotional and then regretted that I'd said anything about it at all. And she reached over and she took my hand and she said, honey, what is it? And I said, I'm gay. And she was like, oh, honey, the most important thing to me is that you're happy. And she never wavered from that. And talk about being able to be launched. The single greatest risk factor for LGBTQ kids is parental rejection. And the single most important factor for full actualization and sense of opportunity and sense of self and being big in the world is parental acceptance. My mother did not know that research. She had not been involved in PFLAG. She didn't even know PFLAG existed. She just knew that that's the way she should respond. My mother had a stroke, her first stroke, in 1996. And she was exactly my age right now. She was 56. And it was debilitating. She never worked again. She could never drive again. She could never handle her finances again. She was still able to live independently in her home, right, just not even a mile from here. But her life changed overnight. About 8 years later, she had a second stroke. And my sister calls me. By this time, I'm living in San Francisco. My sister calls and says, you need to get home right away. Mom's had another stroke. So I get there as soon as I can, and then my mother begins this long, hard slog back. She survived, but now she's beginning the long recovery back from a second debilitating stroke. I'm back probably, it's maybe 6 months or so after, not even six, it's not 6 months, it's maybe 6 weeks after the stroke, and I'm visiting my mom in the hospital, and the speech therapist comes to take my mom for speech therapy. Because she had a lot of aphasia and had a lot of hard time getting words out. So I go with her to the appointment, and the speech therapist is asking her what would normally be very simple questions for my mother to answer. How many kids do you have? Where do your children live? what do your kids do for a living? And through each of these questions, at that point there were only three of us, me, my brother, and my sister, my mother is struggling to come up with the words. So the speech therapist at some point turns to me and says, well, Kathy's here, my family calls me Kathy, Kathy's here. My family calls me Kathy, and there are also people in the audience that still call me Kathy, because anyone who knew me before law school, it's Kathy. For some reason in law school everything changed and I became Kate. So I'm not trying to hide from the law or anything, it just happened. So the speech therapist says, well, Kathy's here from San Francisco, why don't you tell me what Kathy does for a living? And I thought to myself, well, this is going to be fascinating. And the speech therapist the speech therapist is waiting to see what my mother says, and my mom looks at me and she looks at the speech therapist, and then she looks back at me, and looking at me the entire time and not taking her eyes off me, she says, what Kathy does is very important. She takes care of all the lesbians and gays in the world. And the speech therapist looks at me and says, well, that's an awfully big job. My mom died about less than a year after that moment. And yet, having her look at me and having her see me in that way was such a gift. And at the core of that gift was the understanding that my mother loved her faith and she loved me. And it was a faith that actually was damning of me and who I was. But she held both truths with this gentleness. So that's the lesson. And while this still is a struggle for me, I insist that the way I honor my mother is by being open to reaching across difference and having these conversations, and never more than now. Now. When so much hangs in the balance, and there is so much fragility, and there is so much fear, and there is so much targeting of vulnerable communities, now has to be a time where we do things differently. The entire Martin Luther King quote is as follows. Power without love is reckless and abusive. Love without power is sentimental and anemic. Power at its best is love, implementing the demands of justice. And love at its best is power, correcting everything that stands against love. So this is how we move forward. We live in power and love, and that is resistance. And we deploy our privilege to assure that those who are most vulnerable, whether it's this administration or a future administration or in any other context, that those who are most vulnerable understand that we stand in the gap and no one is getting to them without coming through us. That's the difference we make. Thank you so much.
Please feel free. I will try to go and find a mic so I can come around so you don't have to shout.
Yeah.
I love what you said. I feel really good. I don't want to be a bystander. So please tell me how.
So there are, thank you. I appreciate that. So this is what I've seen. This is what gives me actually tremendous hope in this moment. And I saw it really in the days right after the election. Everywhere I went, DC was the first place I went just days after the election. And then I was in several other places around the country. And what I saw over and over again were people essentially saying some version of, not on my watch. So let me tell you how I see it happening in some communities, and this is something that anybody can do. There are a number of immigration organizations that we've been working with and talking with about how can we protect folks who are undocumented, how can we protect immigrant populations who might be targeted by ICE. And so what I've just started doing is going around my neighborhood, and I've written out, it's like a, you know, a pretty short thing with information that says, because I look, I don't know if my Latino neighbors are undocumented or not, but it says, I have no idea whether you or anyone in your family is undocumented, but if you feel under threat from ICE or any other government agency, here are things you should know about what your rights are, and here is my contact information. If you need me to pick up your kids because somebody gets picked up and you need to be somewhere, or you want to, some people have actually said, we're still working on whether my entire family will agree to this. Do you want to switch houses if there are raids that happen in a particular community, and I will trade homes with you? I mean, it is this kind of stuff that we are seeing, like stuff that I would never have thought of before, as a way to say, look, we want to repel what we do not want to see happening in our communities. The other thing that I've seen, and this has happened now in multiple cities, it started in San Francisco with 200 lawyers who wanted to be trained to be on the front line of civil defense in their communities, and it ended up with, we had 1,200 lawyers in the Bill Graham Auditorium being trained by every organization from Muslim advocates to immigrants organizations, to LGBT organizations, about how these lawyers could volunteer as pro bono attorneys to work with these organizations to be on the front lines of defending civil society. Something lawyers have done in many, many autocracies around the world in past times. Never thought we'd have to do it here, but here we are. And we're doing another training in Palm Springs with both activists and lawyers in May. That is something you could do here. And I can get you the schedule, I can get you the information, because I do think the question I get everywhere I go is exactly this question: what can I do? So I'm happy to, maybe Jason, I don't know if I send you a list of organizations that people can contact, ideas, links to, you know, how to communicate with individuals in your neighborhood or communities who you might be concerned could be targeted. There are all sorts of things that people can do. And then let's not underestimate, right now, Congress isn't quite sure what the heck's going to happen. They're not sure which way the wind is going to blow. And whether it's the ACA or whether it's some of these policies around immigration that will require congressional action, not just an executive order, writing to and calling members of Congress, let me just tell you, especially here in California, it's like, oh, well, that's of course, we know what, you know, Feinstein's going to do, we know what Boxer's going to do, we know. But here, your representatives can make a difference to sort of stand in the gap. Now, there's going to be big differences. But everyone in Congress, I'm completely convinced of this, except for maybe a small handful, value our democracy and the institution that they are a part of, want to see three healthy branches of government functioning, want a sane and effective executive in the White House. So there are ways that we can find common ground by saying, okay, we're going to disagree on five or six things, but these are two things that we agree on, and this is where I want you to stand up for my community and for other communities. So doing that, just that retail politics of communicating with your elected officials has never been more important than right now. So there are just some ideas. And I'll send Jason information to get out to folks.
LGBT students feel safe?
Yeah, that's a great question. And well, students in LGBTQ students in Utah have a little bit greater measure of safety this week than they did even a week ago. Last fall, we joined forces with Equality Utah and filed the first ever challenge to Utah's commonly called No Promo Homo Law. This is a law that exists in 8 states, Utah was one of them, that forbids any positive discussion of, quote, homosexuality. So even just a report on Harvey Milk as a gay icon, political leader. Even a report on your attending your aunt's wedding to another woman. This would not be permitted under the law. Certainly no conversation about what it was like for you as a queer kid in middle school or high school. So we filed a lawsuit challenging that law. We had three amazing plaintiffs, a high schooler, a middle schooler, and an elementary kid, who had harrowing stories about how they had been treated, even just wanting to have a positive discussion of LGBT people in their lives. And we felt very confident about our chances in the litigation, but the litigation was mooted out last week when the Utah legislature repealed the no promo homo law, and we think under threat of the litigation, and also I do feel like this is where the common ground. I don't believe any legislator, except for maybe one or two in the Utah legislature, actually actively wants to harm LGBTQ people. And understanding that the inability to even acknowledge that you existed is so stigmatizing and dehumanizing, and the damage and harm that that does, made these legislators stand up and do the right thing. So that law has now been repealed. And so definitely getting that information out, that things are different in Utah legally, and then providing opportunities, being seen. I mean, the way kids get saved who are at risk is by even, and this is again documented over and over again, one adult seeing them and reaching out and caring for them and loving them unconditionally. So the value of just a conversation that says, I see you, what's going on, how can I help, connecting them with resources like the LGBT Center here, connecting them with us at NCLR or other organizations, that just that one, it seems simple, but it is demonstrated time and time again that where any kid, based on any difference, feels marginal or vulnerable, and one person says, I see you and I hold you, that makes a difference. Okay, we got an army of resistors here.
As a trans woman, I'm part of the vulnerable community. I'm lucky enough that I'm white and I'm a veteran, so I have some privileges. But things aren't perfect. I spent 3 years looking for a part-time job after transition, something that before transition, I interviewed and I got the job, and that's how it worked. And so, just keeping myself in food, keeping myself clothed, that's a struggle. So I don't have time for activism myself. I set aside a few hours sometimes to talk to a younger trans person to help them understand what's coming, where they're going. Sometimes I have time to come to an event like this, but right now I'm working, I'm dealing with my own issues as a trans person, trying to establish my identity, trying to get all the legal stuff done, which I still don't have done. If you are privileged, if you have the time, if you have the capital, if you have the money, we need your help, because we're just surviving. And the people who are less privileged than I, trans women of color, are the most affected.
Yep.
What have you seen that someone in my position can do more than I'm doing? Like I say, I can share the information. I can tell people about TU Utah. I can tell people about Equality Utah. I can talk to people about my experiences, but I don't have the time and effort, the energy for more. What are the simple things that I can do? I guess that's my question right now, because I've got a few hours a month, and maybe I could be using that more effectively, but that's all I have.
Well, so the first thing to say is the obvious thing to me, which is you living authentically is your activism. You're resisting every day just by living authentically. So That's good. You're good. You're good. The other thing that's important, and you sort of touched on it, but I feel like, you know, privilege is not a one-size-fits-all. And so when I speak predominantly to LGBTQ white audiences, I make very clear that moving in the world as a queer white person means that you're deploying a privilege you actually don't deserve, and that's your passing privilege. Many LGBTQ people pass as heterosexual, not because they don't like look or dress or walk like a lesbian, but because heteronormativity is so infused, people don't see queer. They see straight. They see non-gay. And only if you really are at the margins of gender nonconformity is that ever interrogated. So most white queer people move in the world with tremendous privilege that people of color who are LGBT don't have, and that people of color generally don't have. A person of color walks out of their house almost, and this is true in almost every case, I mean, it's a small minority of maybe people of color can pass, but a person of color usually walks out of their house and has to face every single day the reaction people have to their race. And sometimes things go without a hitch and it's fine, and other times it's like, why are you following me in this store? Or why are you talking to me that way? Or why I'm with other people, why do you not look at me and talk to me? You talk to other people. Why did I not get that job? I mean, it's like relentless interrogation about, because we live in such a racist, white supremacist culture. So what I would say is you are deploying everything you can, understanding the privilege that you have. If everyone else deployed their privilege in service of others who had less privilege based on any basis, we would be in a far different place in this country. And I'm actually hoping that this moment of such tremendous political disruption will remind people, will shake people out of the complacency that as long as you're taken care of in your little box, in your little world, you don't have to worry about anybody else. If we actually break through that and say, not only are we going to resist and stop the worst that this administration might do in targeting more vulnerable populations, but we're actually going to end up with a political dynamic and a nation where we've upended patriarchy and white supremacy, and we're going to do things really differently down the road because we take this disruption and we use it to really change the culture. But it requires people deploying their privilege in a way we've never had to before. But if anything can do it, it can be this moment.
My sister and her partner have two kids. They're raising two kids.
Right.
And they live in Utah County, Happy Valley, I think it is. And so their kids are in school and in sports, and they're both very involved. But it seems like they have to hide a lot of being gay because of discrimination. It just seems like it's so unfair. They're very loving. So I was just wondering if there's something that I could share with them that they didn't have to try and hide the fact that they're gay.
Yeah, that's kind of, well, I don't know if how much of their fear is real or it's perceived that they would not be accepted and embraced. Because this is the thing, especially in a moment where, again, this is a moment of disruption. Showing up as your full authentic self and giving someone an opportunity to accept you as your full authentic self, the person who's accepting you, that's an act of resistance in a culture that says we shouldn't be accepting people who are different than us. So giving people a chance and an opportunity to show up as their best selves, the first thing I say is take some risks. But the other thing I should mention is that I just came from Utah County. I've been in Spanish Fork for the last week, waiting for the birth of my grandson, who does not appear anxious to show up. He is well past his due date. My daughter, Emily, and her wife, Heather, live in Spanish Fork. And they have a great life there. Their neighbors know that they're a lesbian couple. It's kind of hard to not know, especially with one of them being pregnant. It's like, whoa, how did that happen? And so if you move in the world as if happens, as if it's going to be okay. So I would say take a few more risks. The other thing to point out is that my daughter, Emily, now 35, my former partner, Lori, and I raised her in Ogden when she was, she's now 35, so this is 30 years ago. We lived in Riverdale. And we did a lot of the covering too. Although I have to say, when a kid shows up, you can be in the closet, and then a kid shows up and it's like, oh crap, this isn't working, like as well. But we were not out. We were not out to school teachers and all of that as a couple. And you know, I'm not saying we made the right decision or the wrong decision. I think this is a very individual choice about how open and out to be. But I do feel like this is a moment also of taking some risks. And so that would be the first thing I'd say, but don't, you know, be strategic about the risks. And then I'll introduce them to my sister and her wife. So they'll have, at least there'll be four lesbians in Utah County.
I was curious if you could speak a little about your professional path from law school to where you are today.
Sure. It's circuitous. I was the first to go to college in my family, and I was telling Enrique that when I told my dad I wanted to go to college, his response was, well, I hope you know I'm not paying for it. So there wasn't a lot of encouragement about getting higher education, but I did. I got a debate scholarship. So that's what enabled me to be a student at Weber State. And oh my God, I love debate. I had an amazing time and it changed my life. Then because of Jane, largely because of Jane's encouragement, it's totally true, I applied to University of Utah Law School. I did not get in first time I applied because I was enjoying debate too much and not really my classes. Sorry, President White. But I'm sure that's not true anymore, and that students are fully well-rounded and really attend to their classes. So my GPA had suffered, so I took the LSAT again, did better, and then got accepted to the University of Utah. Went to law school. My first job out of law school was at a big firm. At the time, I had clerked with Jane through law school, became a better lawyer based on that experience. Got this job at a firm, worked at a firm for a while, and then saw this position for the first staff attorney for the ACLU of Utah, and thought, I remember looking at the Utah Bar Journal, seeing that job announcement, closing it, sitting back in my chair and thinking, oh my God, I want that job. I want that job. I want that job. And it happened and was an amazing experience. I was there for 3 years and then met my now wife and fell head over heels. She was at the ACLU of Northern California. So we had a year and a half long distance relationship, and then I moved to San Francisco to take the position as legal director at the National Center for Lesbian Rights. So now I was a professional gay, getting paid for being a lesbian. It's a good gig if you can get it. And then in 1996, I became executive director at NCLR. So I really still cannot believe this because I actually think I have a touch of ADHD. So the fact that for 21 years I've been executive director at NCLR still shocks me. But that's the state of affairs. And I wouldn't change anything about that. If somebody, you know, said, well, rewind the clock and you can go to Harvard and Princeton or Yale or wherever. Pick anywhere you want to go to college. Pick anywhere you want to go to law school. Super credentialed, clerk for a Supreme Court justice, but you obviously can't have the life you've had. I would never take that deal. I got it exactly right doing what I did and feel very fortunate to be living the life I'm living.
So I come from a very Mormon family, and my sister is still involved in the church, but wants to raise her daughters with an open mind and accepting of all people and decisions they make. How would you suggest that parents who try to balance a religion which is intolerant to LGBT people, but also teach your kids to be tolerant?
That's a great question, and congratulations on your essay, by the way. You know, my sister walks this talk in such a great way. My sister is very devout. She and her husband both were, like, I don't know, he was branch president, and she was in some position, and you know, my sister has continued to be very, very active in the church. Has four kids who are all completely supportive of me. I have a great relationship with them, and now, they have a passel of grandkids too, and I have great relationships with them. And the way my sister handled it, and I do think this is could be true of any parent, is kind of the way my mom handled it. Because I would remember asking my mom, "Mom, how do you hold your testimony so firmly and your support of me? I mean, these things are in conflict." And her response was always, "God gave me both. He gave me my testimony, and He gave me you. And I know my responsibility is to love them both." And she really meant that. And my sister does much the same thing, where we understand. I have no interest in changing Mormon doctrine. That's not going to happen, and it's not my fight. I don't have any interest in it. But what I do think we can agree on is that we live in a constitutional democracy where people should be treated fairly and equally and free from stigma, and that is a universal human value. And it transcends any particular religious ideology. My sister may believe in her heart of hearts that, you know, she's not gonna see me in any afterlife, that I'm gonna be off cast away with all the other gays, which is fine by me, that I'm gonna be off, you know, like not at the right hand of God or whatever it is she thinks. But she, on this earth, she knows that the values that she cares about of inclusion and love and having her kids have a degree of acceptance and embracing of difference, that those are every bit as important and not in conflict with fidelity to church doctrine. Church doctrine does not require people to condemn people of different faiths or who live a different life. And I do feel like there is a beauty in Mormonism around a greater degree of acceptance than some others. And so it's just walking that line and really communicating that the world is an amazing place, and the diversity is not something to fear. It is something to encourage, and it is something that enhances one's life, even as you have a particular faith that you adhere to. I think you can hold both, and acting like they're not in conflict is probably the best way to go.
So when you're talking about reaching a common ground with someone that polar opposites with you, how would you suggest going about that?
So I just spoke at my sister's high school last month. She teaches at Park City High School, and it was an assembly with about 300 kids, and one of the students stood up and said, "So my family supports Trump, voted for Trump. I support Trump. I support his policies, but I know a lot of people disagree. I'm willing to have those conversations, but I don't know how." It's an interesting kind of different perspective. And I think the most important way to approach those difficult conversations is with curiosity. Tell me what you're thinking. Tell me how that makes you feel. Tell me what you're afraid of. Tell me why you embrace that. Tell me, you know, what are the factors that inform your opinion? To really just come from a place of inquiry. Now, I want to be clear. You can't have it, like, I'm not going to have a conversation, I feel like it's important just to state maybe the obvious. If you're a person of color, do not have a conversation with an avowed racist, okay? You know, if you're a queer person, do not have a conversation with an avowed intransigent homophobe, okay? So there are things that you just can't do that would just be too harmful to your whole soul. But to have conversations with people who are also struggling and willing to admit a degree of humility and fragility around their opinion, like, I'm not quite sure. I think this is the way I feel. This is what I'm concerned about. That opens up a place of conversation. And curiosity and inquiry, I mean, who doesn't want to be asked about themselves? Tell me about yourself. Tell me where you came from. Tell me how you got to that opinion. That, and then over a few of those questions back and forth, well, you know what? I've been to Alabama too, you know? And so it's like something's gonna come up that creates some common ground, and then you build on that. But it requires patience. It's not gonna happen in one conversation.
We may have time for one or two more questions. anybody? Well, then let's give Kate a round of applause.
Thank you. It's great to be here. Thank you.